Hi all, welcome to the second session of Ethics in Mains Maxima series. Today we will be discussing three questions. The first question is on death penalty, the ethics of death penalty. The second question is pertaining with social ethics, the ethical problems arising out of poverty and inequality. And the third would be on attitude formation. Let's go to the first question. Death penalty is inadmissible because it is an attack on inviolability and dignity of the person. Comment. The question says that death penalty is attack on inviolability of human dignity. Human dignity is foremost of all values. Human dignity should not be disturbed. Human dignity should not be attacked. And death penalty is a direct attack on the inviolable nature of human dignity. That is what the question is speaking about. We have different ethical philosophers giving different perspectives about the death penalty. They either support death penalty or they oppose death penalty. We have to introduce all those concepts while writing the answer for this question. Let's go to the model answer. What is the idea behind creating a punishment? Punishments are an integral part of any society. The main propositions for introducing any punishment is to penalize the wrongdoing, to discourage anyone to indulge in wrongdoing. That is the main idea behind introduction of punishments in a society. So the main reasons for introducing punishment is, it is a person who has done wrong has to suffer for his wrongdoing. The second reason is, inflicting punishment for wrongdoers, it discourages the other persons from indulging in any wrong activities. Death penalty, we have different kinds of punishment given to different wrongs committed by an individual. Death penalty is an extreme punishment given by a state to a committer of any heinous crime. So the state condemns the act by sentencing the convicted to the death. This is the rationale behind a death penalty given by the state. In India, the Bachchan Singh case has laid down the extraordinary circumstances in which the court can award death penalty or capital punishment to an individual. So what is this inviolability of an individual? In our constitution, the article 21 has given us the right to life. A right to life includes leading a life with dignity, and the dignity also includes dignity of death as given, as mentioned in the recent euthanasia case by the Supreme Court. So every individual has a dignity at birth, and he also has the right to die with dignity. This forms the inviolability of human dignity. What is this inviolability of an individual? Inviolability or the sanctity of life is based on the principle or based on the theory that human life is holy, sacred, or otherwise it has such values which should not be violated. And this inviolability principle can be applied to both humans and animals. This is the ideal behind the ethics of Indian religions, ahimsa. And also the Western philosophy like utilitarianism also accords equal importance to the lives of both human and animals equally. Dignity is a basic human right. Every individual born in this world has a right to live with dignity, that is a right to have a respectable life, and he has a right not to be disturbed while leading his life. This forms the core of dignity. Each and every human being has an innate dignity that must be respected. First, we have seen why the punishments are being given in the society. Then we have discussed what is death penalty. And then we have discussed which criteria defines indiction of death penalty in India. Then we went to the terms given in the question. First, we discussed about inviolability of an individual. And we have explained what is inviolability. Then we have explained the dignity of a human being. We have explained what is dignity of human being is. Now we have gone to, we have come to the third part of the question, that is the arguments against death penalty. So why death penalty should be avoided? In the theories of value-based ethics, virtue is given more importance. And one of the most important virtue is giving respect to human values. And there is an inviolable value present for human life. And death penalty is violating this particular value of human life. So in the perspective of virtue-based ethics, death penalty should be avoided. And every individual born in this world has an innate right to live. Giving a capital punishment, taking life out of an individual, amounts to state-sponsored violence. This state-sponsored violence was mentioned by a philosopher called Bakaria. Few philosophers argue that death penalty is an retributive justice given by the state. Retributive justice is not fair. justice has to be fair, says philosopher John Rawls. The often quoted Mahatma Gandhi's quote that an eye for eye will make the society blind. So retributive justice should be avoided, and hence death penalty should be avoided. The next important aspect is it brutalizes the society. It takes the humanity away from the society. The society of human beings is constructed, it's interlinked by the values of humanity, and introducing death penalty as a tool to punish the wrongdoers will suck away, will absorb away the humanity from the society. So it brutalizes the society. Apart from all this, death penalty is too expensive for an individual. How it is expensive? Death penalty takes away an individual from a family, then the family should have been dependent on that particular individual, loses the sole breadwinner of the family. So it becomes expensive for the family and it affects the societal interaction. So far we have seen the arguments given by the ethical philosophers against death penalty. Now we will have a brief look into the arguments of philosophers who have supported death penalty. The major philosopher who has supported death penalty is Immanuel Kant. Immanuel Kant has recommended death penalty for two particular cases. One is murder, and second is any conspiracy against the country or emperor. So, murder. Immanuel Kant says that killing a person is violation of his natural right and killing a person is immoral. So he has recommended death penalty for murder. And in the similar aspect, he says that it is moral duty of every individual citizen of a country to respect the emperor. And any conspiracy to depose the emperor amounts to murder, amounts to violation of the moral duty of an individual. So he has recommended death penalty for conspiracy against empire. And the next most important school of philosophy which recommends death penalty is utilitarian school of philosophy. According to this philosophy, the main theme is maximum good for maximum people. The philosophers belonging to this utilitarian school of thought, they argue that by providing death penalty to a criminal, the state is bringing benefit to the society. So the utilitarian philosophers, they support death penalty. Whatever be the case, death penalty violates the right of an individual. So Kantian school of philosophy and utilitarian school of philosophy, they both support the death penalty. Now we have seen the two different views, the one that opposes death penalty, one that supports death penalty. Now it's time for conclusion. It is the duty of the state, murder of a person by the state in the name of death penalty amounts to killing of a person by the state. But it is universally accepted that it is a duty of the state to protect the citizens and not to kill its citizens. So death penalty is violative of the state's duty. Apart from this, it also violates the individual's dignity and individual's right to live. Only by considering the dignity of human individuals, dignity of life, Catholic Church in its recently released Universal Catechism has rightly argued for abolishing death penalty for any criminal activities. Let's move to the second question. The second question is on social ethics. This particular question deals about poverty and inequality. Poverty and inequality are one of the most pressing problems in the present world. Poverty and inequality, it's not only an economical problem, it also creates ethical problems. So let's move to the question. There is widespread concern that economic growth has not been fairly shared and that the economic crisis has only widened the gap between rich and poor. Discuss the ethical problems associated with poverty and inequality. So the question mentions that the spillover of economic growth or the output of economic growth is not being fairly shared, leading to inequality, leading to income disparity between haves and have-nots, widening the gap between the income level of haves and have-nots. And this economic crisis, and apart from this, the prevailing economic crisis, that is poverty, has only widened the gap between the rich and poor. Based on this question, we have to analyze, we have to mention what are the ethical problems arising out of poverty and inequality. Poverty and inequality, they are long existing roadblocks in inclusive development of human society. Earlier, after the industrial revolution, after the countries got industrialized, the countries followed a trickle-down economical model, trickle-down industrialization model. But the trickle-down industrialization model led to inequality. Now the focus has turned to social development based model of economy. Let's consider the case of India. India has been posting consistent growth, and India has been tagged as the fastest growing economy in the world, and India has pipped China in becoming the fastest economy of the world. But the rate of inequality is high in India, and it's increasing in India. So eradicating poverty and rectifying extreme levels of inequality go hand in hand with economic growth. What does abolishing inequality and abolishing poverty mean? Abolishing inequality and abolishing poverty is nothing but inclusive development. Inclusive development is broad-based participation of people. Broad-based participation of people in productive activities, it will increase the nation's total output of goods and services, and this will increase the pace of nation's economic development. This poverty and inequality, which were supposed to be the economic problems, they are not only economical problems, they also have an ethical facet attached with them. What are the challenges posed by poverty, the ethical challenges posed by poverty? According to the Nicomachean Ethics of Aristotle, happiness is the highest aim of any individual who is following the virtues and morals. So happiness is the highest aim of any individual. Poverty deprives the opportunity, a chance for a people to achieve their highest goal, that is happiness. The world of poverty is posing us four different challenges. The first challenge is social challenge. The social fabric is decimated because of poverty. Second is cultural challenge. What is a cultural challenge? See, poor people cannot afford for education, and lack of education leads to cultural challenge. Then we have ecological challenge. Then the world poverty also poses us ethical challenge. These four challenges are linked in a vicious cycle, which is harming the upward mobilization of human society in value-based cycle. So eradication of poverty is supported by equal access to quality education and a fairer society, so that everyone receives education and can have options in their life. Education creates options. Education removes the darkness from one's life. Education shows light on the road ahead of an individual. It shows multiple paths for individual to grow. And education is a main source through which an individual can attain its attitude formation. Education is a source by which one can inculcate proper moral values. Education is a source through which one can grow virtue-based ethics on oneself. Education is a way to improve maturity of an individual. So education is most important in eradicating or countering the challenges created by the poverty in the modern society. Education will give more option to individuals in their lives, and this will help in fulfilling the aspirations of the individual. Education, by providing an option for a livelihood, will help the individual to attain his highest aim, that is to realize happiness in one's life. As I mentioned earlier, universal access to education is not only providing opportunity for employment, it is an opportunity to improve one's own life. And the challenges which I discussed earlier, they question the ethical responsibility of an haves. The poverty is the problem of have-nots. The free-thinking, liberal-minded, ethical, morally induced people who have enough wealth to run their life, they have moral obligation to stand for the have-nots. So we saw the challenges posed by poverty. Now we see the challenges posed by inequality. Inequality also tests our ethics. What is inequality? Inequality, Thomas Piketty, the developmental economist, he defines inequality as a situation where the return on investment for capitalists is more than the growth of a country, economic growth of the country, or is greater than G, defines inequality. This inequality creates stratification of income. Apart from the income gaps, there are also some ethical problems posed by inequality. As far as Indian philosophy is concerned, the ultimate aim of any individual is Purushartha. What is Purushartha? Purushartha is the final destination to be reached by a Purusha, human. So what are the components of Purushartha? Dharma, Artha, Kama and Moksha. here. The present society is moving towards a materialist culture where the amount of possession decides what they possess, decides their social status. But if we delve into the teachings of Indian philosophy, we'll get to know that Dharma is given highest prominence. Dharma is ethics. Living by the values of ethics, living by the moral values has to be given more importance. The inequality is driving people to move diametrically away from the ethical regulations given by Indian philosophy. The society is united by a cohesive force. The cohesive force is trust between people. Without the trust, the society won't exist. Trust is an glue that binds the people together in the society. So, what happens in the case of high inequality? The breach of trust between the individual elements of the society will lead to lack of social cohesion, and this may lead to a deviant and anomic society. And the problems of Naxalism is a best example for a deviant or anomic society. And a reasonable degree of social cohesion is required in order to have a functional society. Only a functional society can give opportunities for people to improve their opportunities in life. So what should be our way forward? As we discussed earlier, while deliberating about the challenges posed by poverty in the modern society, education is the most important solution. Education is the most crucial solution in averting the challenges posed by poverty and inequality. Education is the precursor to any revolution. Be it the French Revolution, be it the American Revolution, education was the important reason. Only the educated, enlightened philosophers, they created the base for any revolution or change in the society. So education will create social change in the society, which would bring in an equality in the society. And education has to be offered equally to everyone. Only an equal education will create an equal society. In the next question is about attitude formation. What is attitude formation? Attitude formation is a dynamic process. Attitude formation is a progressive process which an individual acquires from his childhood, what he observes, what he learns, what he does, and all these activities will form the attitude of an individual. And in order to have a constructive attitude formation, there should be wider perspective of thought, wider perspective of action available to the individual, that too mainly in his young stage of life. So let's go to the question. Dialectical discussion of ideas will contribute to constructive attitude formation among the youth. So what is dialectical discussion? Dialectical discussion is considering all the options available over a particular subject. That is, we saw the example of death penalty. So we discussed the arguments which supported death penalty. We discussed the arguments which opposed death penalty. Based on this, we came to a conclusion. That is a dialectical discussion. So dialectical discussion will open new perspectives for an individual. This dialectical discussion will contribute to a constructive attitude formation, a positive attitude formation in the youth. This is what the question is all about. So let's go to the model answer. While writing introduction, as I mentioned in the earlier video, the introduction has to be attractive to induce the evaluator to give you more marks, to induce the evaluator to read your paper with an keen interest. So let's start with a quote. German philosopher Hegel has mentioned that thesis and antithesis, arguments for and against a subject, thesis and antithesis, they both synergize and create a synthesis of new ideas. That is, thesis and antithesis lead to synthesis of new ideas. So as I mentioned earlier, attitude formation by itself is dynamic, and in the attitude formation in younger generation is even more dynamic. Younger generation, they observe more, their earning to learn more is high, so they are more dynamic. According to the neuroscientists, the attitude formation is caused by three important factors. One is by conditioning. Second is by role playing. Conditioning, role playing, and third is observation. Along with these three methods, role models also have a role to influence the attitude formation in youngsters. So role model, as I mentioned earlier, role models have an important role in shaping the attitude formation of an individual. And these role models, they act as reference individuals for the youth. What the youth do, they see the reference individual and they tend to follow the ideal set by the reference individual. So the reference individual or to the liking of the youngsters. they follow the actions of the reference individual or the role model. What happens is, because of this, the perspective gets narrowed, and this reduces the dynamism involved in attitude formation. And a German philosopher Nietzsche says that the way to corrupt a youth is to allow him to follow those who think alike and those who think differently. So following a single reference individual will corrupt the attitude formation of a youth. We all know that the societal cohesion is built by difference of opinions. A monolithic society is a myth, says Amartya Sen. So the society is constructed by difference of opinions, and making an youngster to follow only one opinion would corrupt the mind. And evils of the world like fascism and Nazism are the result of single-minded following of like-minded persons. So in Indian theosophical philosopher Jiddu Krishnamurti, he says that when one tends to follow a particular idea without having counter opinion about that idea, he tends to speak life for that particular idea. So youngsters following a particular idea without any dialectical analysis will violate doctrine of truth. As I mentioned earlier, allowing discussions over differently thinking persons will widen the perspective of an individual, thus improving the dynamism involved in attitude formation. This wider perspective of opinions will allow the knowledge to progress, will widen the tolerance, which is a much needed value in the present Indian situation, and increases the reception among the youth for new ideas. Recently, in a case, Supreme Court had observed that dissent is the safety valve of democracy. So dissent and difference will create an attitude of positivity in a society. I repeat, dissent and difference will create an attitude of positivity in a society. Synergy between the thoughts of like and unlike will create healthy attitude formation for the younger generation. This healthy attitude formation in the younger generation, it has a dividend over forthcoming years of a society. So to conclude with, we can use the quote of Friedrich Nietzsche. The surest way to corrupt a youth is to instruct him to hold in higher esteem those who think alike than those who think differently. Thank you.